So now let us solve one question based upon the rotation of complex number in argon plane. So the question is that we are given that z1 and z2 are the roots of this equation, that is z square plus px plus q equals to 0, and we are given that p and q may be complex number. So we know that the coefficient of p and the q are even complex numbers. Now we are also given that a is represented by z1 and b is represented by z2 in the argon plane. We are given some more information, that is angle AOB equals to alpha and OA is equals to OB. And what we have to prove is P square is equals to 4 Q cos square alpha by 2. Now let us try to represent this complete situation on an argon diagram. So let us draw an argon diagram representing it. This is my x axis, this is my imaginary axis. What we are given, this z1 and z2 are represented by point A and B on the argon plane. So let's say A is this point and B is this point. A is representing complex number z1, B is representing complex number z2, and we are given that angle AOB equals to alpha. So this angle is equals to alpha. Now what we see from this equation is, this point is O, that is the origin. OA is equals to OB, that we are given in the question, and the angle between OA and OB is alpha. So we can easily say that since the modulus of these two lines, the modulus of these two is equal, OB is nothing, but it can be always derived by rotating OA by an angle alpha in anti-clockwise direction. And once again, what I am saying is OB can always be obtained by rotating OA by an angle alpha in anti-clockwise direction. I am telling this because the modulus of OB and OA is equal, and the only difference between OB and OA is the angle alpha that is between them. So if we rotate OA by an angle alpha, what we are going to get is this angle, is this vector OB. So I can write this here as, OB is equals to OA into e to the power iota alpha, where alpha is the angle between OB and OA, which we already given in the question. Now we know that B is represented by Z2 and A is represented by Z1. So I can write OB as Z2 minus 0 and OA as Z1 minus 0 into e to the power iota of alpha. I can write this as Z2, Z1 e to the power iota alpha is cos alpha plus sin alpha. This is cos alpha plus iota of sin alpha. So I can, from here I can write z2 by z1 is equals to cos alpha plus iota of sin alpha. I have derived this equation. Now I can even write this as z2 by z1 is equals to cos square alpha by 2 plus iota, cos square alpha, I can write cos alpha is cos square alpha by 2 minus 1 plus iota 2 sin alpha by 2 into cos alpha by 2. I have just expanded cos alpha and sin alpha. Transferring this one here, I can write z2 upon z1 plus 1 is equals to, I am taking, this is 2 cos square alpha by 2, so I am taking 2 cos alpha by 2 common. This as cos alpha by 2 plus iota of sin alpha by 2. I am squaring both the sides. So what I get here, z2 by plus z1 whole square upon z1 whole square is equals to 4
cos square alpha by 2 into cos alpha by 2 plus iota sin alpha by 2 whole square.
Now I can easily apply de Morgan's theorem here, which says cos theta plus iota sin theta to the power n is always equals to cos n theta plus iota sin n theta. Here theta is alpha by 2 and n is 2.
So I can always write
cos alpha by 2 plus iota sin alpha by 2 whole square as cos alpha plus iota sin alpha. So this equation boils down to
z2 plus z1 whole square upon z1 square
is equals to
4 cos square alpha by 2
into cos alpha plus iota sin alpha.
Now this term cos alpha plus iota sin alpha can be substituted by z2 plus z1.
You already derived this here and I call this as equation 1. So I can put cos alpha plus iota sin alpha is z2 by z1 here. So what I get
is z2 plus z1 whole square upon z1 square is equals to 4 cos square alpha by 2 into z2 by z1.
Transferring this complete term here, what I get is
z2 plus z1 whole square is 4 cos square alpha by 2 into z1.
I hope everyone is clear with this complete thing. Now we know that z1 and z2 are the roots of this equation z square plus px plus q equals to 0. So I can say for this equation
z square plus px plus q equals to 0,
where its root
are z1 comma z2,
the summation of roots,
that is z1 plus z2, can be written as minus p, and the multiplication of roots, that is z1 into z2, can be written as q.
Once again, I know that z1 and z2 are the roots of this equation, that is z square plus px plus q equals to 0. So the summation of root would be minus p and the multiplication of roots would be plus q. When I observe this equation, in this equation I can substitute z1 by z2 by minus p whole square equal to 4 cos square alpha by 2 z1 into z2 is q. So what I get is p square equals to 4 cos square alpha by 2 into q, and this is what we had to prove. I hope everyone is comfortable with the complete solution. What we did was, we started by observing that OB can always be obtained by rotating OA by an angle alpha in anti-clockwise direction. We had written the same equation here. We knew that OA was equals to OB. We expanded this complete equation to get that z2 by z1 was equals to cos alpha plus iota sin alpha. Then we solved this equation completely and we got this equation, that is z2 plus z1 whole square is 4 cos square alpha by 2 z2 z1. Now since z1 and z2 are the root of this equation, z square plus 4 px plus q equals to 0, we could write z1 by replace z1 plus z2 by minus p and z1 into z2 by q. And replacing the value of z1 and z2 and z1 into z2, we got this our solution as p square equals to 4 cos square alpha by 2. Now the next topic that we are going to discuss under the locus of complex number is the shifting of origin. Everyone was comfortable, I think everyone is comfortable till what we have discussed under locus of complex number till now. The first thing that we discussed was finding the angle between two intersecting lines on a complex number, and the second topic that we discussed was how we can rotate a complex number by an angle alpha in anti-clockwise direction
by multiplying it by e to the power iota alpha and by an angle alpha in clockwise direction by multiplying it by e to the power minus iota alpha. Now the next topic is we are going to discuss is shifting of origin. Call it as we have already seen shifting of origin in case of real numbers. Now let us see how we can do it in case of complex number. So let us draw the Argand plane once again. Now in this case my coordinate axis is passing through a point O. This is my x axis, that is the real axis, and this is my y axis, that is the imaginary axis. Let us say we have a point P here which has its affix z naught with respect to the origin, and let us say we have a point Q which has its affix capital Z with respect to the coordinate axis which are passing through this origin O. Now what I am doing is I am shifting my origin from this point O to this new point P. So now instead of O, my coordinate axis is passing through this point P. Let's draw it dark only. So when the origin was O, the fx of this point Q was capital Z. Now when the origin is P, the fx of this point Q, let's call it Z dash, capital Z dash would be equal to Z minus Z naught. Once again, what we have done is we have shifted our origin to this point P. So when the origin was Q, the fx of this point Q was Z. When the origin is P, let us say the fx of this point Z, new point Z, this point P, Q is Z dash, which would be equal to Z minus Z naught. Similarly, let us say in the case of this point P, initially it had its fx Z naught with respect to the origin. Now when this point P, then the origin was shifted to this point P, its fx would be Z naught minus Z naught, which is equal to 0, which should be because now our origin is this point P. So whenever I shift origin to a new point, then I can always say, so whenever I shift up origin from O to a new point Z naught, I can say, I can always obtain the new fx. I can always say that the previous fx, that is Z, can always be written as the new fx, that is Z dash plus Z naught. This is how we define shifting of origin in case of complex numbers. Let us see one question based on that so that we can understand this complete situation more clearly. The basic point here is that whenever we shift an origin to point Z naught, then the new fx is always obtained by subtracting Z naught from the previous fx, that is new fx Z dash would be equals to Z minus Z naught, or I can say that Z would be equal to Z dash plus Z naught. Let us solve one question based upon this. We will be able to understand this more clearly. So the next question that we have to solve based on the shifting of origin is that we are given that Z1, Z2 and Z3 are the coordinates of an equilateral triangle which has its circumcenter at Z0. Then what we are doing is then changing the origin to Z0, that is we are changing the origin from 0 to Z0. Now we have to show that Z1 dash square plus Z2 dash square plus Z3 dash square is equals to 0, where Z1 dash, Z2 dash and Z3 dash are the new vertices. I will more specifically say they are the new coordinates. So once again, let's see what we are given.
We are given as z1, z2 and z3 are the coordinates of an equilateral triangle with its circumcenter at z0. Now what we are doing is we are changing the coordinate, we are shifting the origin from 0 to z0. And when we are changing the origin from 0 to z0, the vertices are changing from z1 dash, z2 dash, z3 to z1 dash, z2 dash and z3 dash. We have to prove that z1 dash, z2 dash and z3 dash is equals to 0. So let us solve the question first. Let us find what is z0. Now since this is an equilateral triangle, I can say that the circumcenter would be equal to the orthocenter would be equal to the centroid. So in this case, the circumcenter, that is z0, would be equal to the centroid, which would be equal to z1 plus z2 plus z3 upon 3. Thus I can say 3z0 is equals to z1 plus z2 plus z3. Once again, what I am saying is that since this is an equilateral triangle, circumcenter, orthocenter and centroid would be equal. So z0 would be equal to z1 plus z2 plus z3 divided by 3. This implies 3z0 would be equal to z1 plus z2 plus z3. Now one more thing, z1 dash is the new coordinate when our coordinate axis is shifted to a new origin z0. So we can always say that z1 is equals to z1 dash plus z0, or I can even say that when the new origin is shifted to z0, z1 dash would be z1 minus z0. From there I can write z1 equals to z1 dash plus z0. Similarly I can write z2 as z1 dash plus z0, z2 dash plus z0, and z3 at z3 dash plus z0. Now I am replacing the value of z1, z2, z3 in this equation. I get 3z0 is equals to z1 dash plus z0 plus z2 dash plus z0 plus z3 dash plus z0. So what I get here is z1 dash plus z2 dash plus z3 dash is equals to 0. This is the one equation that we have obtained, and we have to find the value of z1 dash square plus z2 dash square plus z3 dash square. So let's do one thing, let's square this complete equation. So what I get here is z1 dash plus z2 dash plus z3 dash whole square is equals to z1 dash square plus z2 dash square plus z3 dash square plus twice z1 dash z2 dash plus twice z2 dash z3 dash plus twice z3 dash z1 dash. Now since this is an equilateral triangle, I can always say that z1 square dash square plus z2 dash square, since it is an equilateral triangle, I can always say that z1 dash square plus z2 dash square plus z3 dash square would be equal to twice z1 dash z2 dash plus twice z2 dash z3 dash and plus twice z3 dash z1 dash. This is the property of an equilateral triangle, which we see that z1 square plus z2 square plus z3 square is equals to twice z1 z2 z2 z3 and z3 z1. So I can replace this by this. I can replace this complete term, that is twice z1 z2 z2 z3 z3 z1 dash, by z1 dash z2 square z3 dash. So I get is twice
z1 dash square, z2 dash square plus z3 dash square is equals to 0. From here what I get is z1 dash plus z2 dash plus z3 whole square is even equals to 0. This is what we had to prove in the question. Once again, let's see what we did was, we said was z0 would be equal to the centroid, because this is an equilateral triangle, so the centroid, circumcenter and orthocenter are all the same point. So I got z0 was equal to z1 plus z2 plus z3 divided by 3. Then since z1 dash was the coordinate which was obtained by was the coordinate of z1, when the origin was shifted from 0 to z0, so I can always write that z1 was equal to z1 dash plus z0. Substituting the value of z1, z2, z3 in this equation, we got was z1 dash plus z2 dash plus z3 dash is equals to 0. Now what we did was we squared this equation. On squaring, since this was an equilateral triangle, we could always say that z1 square plus z2 square plus z3 square is equals to z1, z2 plus z2, z3 plus z3, z1. Actually not 2 here, just this. So I could always replace z1 dash, z2 dash, z2 dash, z3 dash, z3 dash, z1 dash by twice of z1 square, z2 square, z3 square. This is equals to thrice z1 dash square, z2 dash, z3 dash whole square equals to 0, which gives us z1 dash plus z2 dash plus z3 dash whole square equals to 0. This is the solution of the question we had. So today what we have studied was, we studied first of all the exponential representation of complex number, where we could represent any complex number in the form of r into e to the power iota alpha. Then we saw how in the form of vector we can represent addition and subtraction of two complex number. Sorry, we saw how we can represent addition and multiplication of two complex number, and we left division and subtraction as an exercise for us, which if we don't get, we are going to discuss in the next lecture. And then we saw the way we could represent locus of real points on the xy plane. Similarly, we can represent locus of complex numbers on the Argon plane, and then we discuss some properties related to the locus of complex number on Argon plane. I hope everyone is comfortable with today's lecture. If there is any doubt, please bring it up. We will discuss in the next lecture. So let us end our today's lecture here. Tomorrow we are again going to start, we are going to continue this topic of locus of complex number, and we will discuss how we can represent a general equation of straight line on a complex plane, similarly an equation for the hyperbola, ellipse, circle, or maybe how we can represent cross products of two complex number, dot product of two complex number or cross product. Lots of things we will discuss based upon complex number. So we'll end this lecture for today, and we will meet again tomorrow and discuss more on complex numbers.